Hi, my name is Jürgen and I'm a senior IT consultant with the company Infralovers. And today I'm gonna show you how easy it is to deploy a simple web application with HashiCorp Nomad. Nomad is HashiCorp's answer to Kubernetes. So where Kubernetes is a very big multi-service container orchestration platform, Nomad takes a different approach. It's trying to make things as lightweight as possible. Out of the box, Nomad is just an orchestration platform for containers, but also for virtual machines and other things. Today, we're gonna concentrate on the container side. So what I wanna do is deploy this simple Docker container. All it does is it contains an Nginx web server that displays this page. So nothing fancy, but for our first example, I think that should suffice. All right, so what I have now is I've opened my terminal here and I have three distinct terminal tabs here. So the black one is my local workstation where I will do all my local preparations for Nomad. Then I have this green colored one, which is an Ubuntu VM running on AWS. And I have another one that I colored blue. That's another VM running on AWS. And I will use the green one as the Nomad server and the blue one as the Nomad client. So what do I need to set up a Nomad server? Not much, it turns out. All you need to do is install the Nomad binary. All the functionality of Nomad is inside that one binary. All I need to do is to install that on this machine. So let's just go ahead and do that. If you're ever wondering how to do that, you can always check out the documentation of Nomad, where we have the installing part where you can see all the different ways to install Nomad. I'm gonna go the Linux route here. If you're on macOS, you can use Homebrew, for example. I'm gonna go ahead and add the HashiCorp repository to my Linux server. Just some commands that I'm copying from the documentation here. And then it's just a question of doing a sudo apt-get update and installing the Nomad package. How to check if Nomad is installed? I can just enter the Nomad command line command, and you can see Nomad is here installed in version 1.0.3. And that's it. So the binary is installed. It's available for us as a command line tool as well. And all I need to do to start a Nomad server now is to add a configuration file that I can then use to start the server. So let's just create it. I'm just gonna stay here in my home directory and create a server HCL file. So let me add the content of this file just very quickly. As you can see, I have a couple of lines in here. The first one is defining the log level. So I want a lot of log output for this. As it is a demo in production setup, I wouldn't set it to debug. I need a data directory for the server where it can put all its data while running. I've chosen the temp directory. You can choose, of course, whatever you want. And then we add this server config block here that has one attribute set enabled set to true and another one bootstrap underscore expect to 1. So what does this mean? If I want to start a Nomad server, all I need to do is to add this server config block to the configuration and set the enabled attribute to true. That tells the Nomad binary that it should start a server. If I would want to start a client, this would look different, right? But that's the only difference between a client and a server, that there's a different configuration inside that .hcl file that we use to start up the binary. Enable true obviously means that this is a server, and bootstrap expect means that when the server starts up, it should expect this number of servers to be running. So this server will be happy as soon as it starts. In a production environment, you would set this to 3 or 5. We're gonna go into detail on that in another video. But that's it. So I can save the file. And now to start the server, all I need to do is use this command, nomad agent minus config server.hcl. So I'm referencing the file I've just created. And I hit enter, and you can see the server is starting up. And I can now simply access that server through its either public IP address or domain name. I'm just using what AWS has given me. Server will be listening on port 4646. And if you want to access its UI, it's /UI/jobs. Hit enter and you can see suddenly we have a nice Nomad dashboard here. There's not much going on at the moment, so we don't have any clients registered, but we have our server, right, that is running on that IP address with that port in data center one. All right, now that our server is running, it's time to add a client to our server. The process is very similar to creating the server. I again install the Nomad binary. So now Nomad is also installed on the client virtual machine. Additionally to the Nomad binary, I will also install Docker on this virtual machine as I want to run a Docker container with the help of Nomad. For that, I just downloaded the very convenient get-docker.sh file and I'm just running that to install Docker. Right now that Docker is installed on the client machine, we can create another configuration file for our client to start up. As you can see, it looks very similar as the server configuration file. We have the same log level setting. We have a data directory. This time, this is called client one. I can also give this client a name. I just discovered that we have a typo here. Let me just fix that very quickly, right? So, and then we have the client configuration block that's also set to true, so enabled to true, which basically now tells the Nomad binary to start up a client instead of a server. It says server join here in the server join stanza, where I have a list of all the servers that it should try to contact. It will try that three times. Also here on the bottom, I'm setting a port for the client. Default is 5656. So all that's left to do is now put in the actual URL of our server. Let me just again copy this very quickly. This is the FQDN of our server. I'm saving that. And everything that's left to do now is just start up that Nomad agent again, but with that client config, right? And you can see also this one here is starting up. Here it is. So it took a couple of seconds to register with the server, but here you can see there's a new client registered here in the dashboard. Its name is client one. It's ready. There's its IP address also running in data center one. I can open up this client and see what's going on. As you can see at the moment, there are like a couple of megabytes of memory being used on the machine. So Nomad also gives me insights into some metrics of the client machine. Now that our server and client are running and communicating, it's time to run an actual job on our Nomad cluster. For that, I've switched to the terminal tab on my local machine. Nomad should also be installed on my local workstation, so I can just check, and it is. It's the same version as on the server and the client. To run a job, I need to connect my local installation of Nomad with the Nomad server. And that is very easy to do. All I need is to set an environment variable called Nomad underscore ADDR. So that's the Nomad address with the address of my Nomad server. In a production setup, that would be obviously an HTTPS URL. And of course, there would be some form of authentication or password protection behind this. But for this test setup, you know, I'm ignoring all the security rules. So I'm just gonna set this. And with Nomad server members, I can get a list of all the running servers in my Nomad cluster. And with Nomad status, I can see which jobs are running on that cluster at the moment. And as you can see, there are no jobs running, but we're gonna change this right now. To run a job on the Nomad server, all we need to do is to create a configuration file for that job and then submit the job to the server. So I simply create a demo. I'm calling it demo because this is my, you know, Nomad demo. .nomad file. So this is not the .hcl file this time. This has a .nomad file extension. And I've again prepared the code already. So I'm just pasting this in. And you can see there's a little bit more going on than with the client and the server config. Let me go through it step by step. So the important thing here to know is that each .nomad file, like each job configuration, has one job our job is called demo. And as you can see, it contains all the other configuration we want to have. Right underneath it, I can define multiple attributes, for example, in which data center this job should run. If you remember, I only set one data center, it's called DC1, as both virtual machines are running in the same AWS region. So I just called that data center 1. And then I can set as what type I want this job to run. I want to run this as a service. So this means that I want to have whatever I described down here started and being run at all times in my Nomad cluster. Then I get to the groups dancer. I call this dancer web. A group defines a set of tasks. You can see the task down here. It's only one task at the moment, but I could have multiple tasks. And the important thing here is the tasks of this group will always be allocated to the same client machine. Those groups can be moved by Nomad to different machines in the same data center, but it is important that the tasks all stay together, right? So this is very similar to a Kubernetes pod, if you ever saw something like that. That's also the basic idea behind the group. Then inside the groups dancer, I'm setting a count attribute, which says how many of those tasks should be run. Then we have the network dancer, where we are setting a port. I'm setting a port that I call HTTP to be port 80. And I'm also assigning it to a static port 80. What does that mean? So the two parameter here means that I want to take port 80 from inside the Docker container. So the Nginx running inside the Docker container is running on port 80 and is being exposed to the outside on another port. And here I'm setting this also to 80. So I want this port 80 inside the Docker container be exposed on the port 80 to the outside. It means port 80 on our virtual machine will be taken by that Docker container. If we remove this, Nomad will choose the port that is being exposed to the outside. Then we come to the most important part of our job definition, the task stanza, which I've called Nginx because it contains the configuration to run our little Nginx example. A task is an individual unit of work in Nomad. So it gets resources, it gets CPU, it will be scaled. And this particular task, as you can see, is utilizing a Docker driver, which means it should be run on a client machine that can support Docker. If you remember, we've set that up on our client virtual machine. I can give this a config stance as well, where I say which specific Docker image should be used. I'm using the Nginx demos / hello colon latest image, and I'm assigning it the HTTP port that we've created up here. Here on the bottom, another stanza, it's called resources, and I'm setting the maximum resources that I want this task to have. CPU 100 means to assign 100 megahertz to this task, and memory needs 128 megabytes of memory will be assigned. Something I might not have mentioned earlier, even though the file extension is .nomad, all this syntax in here is still HashiCorp language. All that's left to do is to save the file. To submit the job to my Nomad cluster, all I need to do is to type nomad job run and the name of the file. And you can see it's being submitted to the Nomad cluster. Checking in my Nomad dashboard, I can now check the jobs tab where you can see the demo job is now pending. So Nomad is now evaluating what needs to be done to run this job, and then it will allocate resources to it. When everything is good, it will give us a green status and our application will be running on our Nomad cluster. And as you can see, demo is now running. And I can open up the job, I can look inside of here in the dashboard. I can see, I can do my task group, do my allocation. And I can see it's chugging away using not much resources and it is available on this address. Of course, this is a local IP, so this won't work if I click it, right? Because this is not a public IP. Of course, I have a domain name for my client. And if I enter this, it will open at port 80 automatically. And I can see there's an Nginx server running, which is our image that we've just deployed with Nomad. So very, very easy to do. If I don't want to run this anymore, I can stop it here in the dashboard. Of course, I can also check on my Nomad jobs on the terminal by running Nomad status again, right? And you can see now that my jobs are being listed on the command line. You can see there is our demo job, Nomad status demo, for more information. And you can see again all the info that I just saw in the dashboard in here. There is one task group running, one allocation running since a couple of minutes, right? Everything seems to be healthy. I can even go deeper with Nomad alloc status and then the ID of my allocation, right? You can see even more. You can see that the Nginx is running. You can see what resources are being used, what the lifecycle of our allocation is currently. So very, very cool. But now our web application that we have running here has become the most popular web application on the internet, right? Everybody wants to see our cool Nginx demo Docker image. But one container that we are running right now is not enough anymore to manage all that traffic. So we will scale up our allocation here from one container to three. To scale up our demo deployment, we just need to do a couple of small changes to our demo.nomad file. First of all, we want to increase the count. So instead of one container, we want to actually run three. But this poses a challenge for us because we have port 80 tied statically. And of course, there can only be one allocation to port 80. We can't have three different containers bound to the same port. So I'm going to remove that here and let Nomad choose the port for me. So what this now means is that it should take the port 80 from the container, but instead of tying it to the port 80 of the virtual machine that we are running on, just choose any higher port that you see fit. And then usually, you know, you would have a load balancer that registers all three of those containers. And that one is then using the port 80 assigned to the FQDN. Just gonna save this. And to apply the changes, we again run Nomad job run demo Nomad. And our changes are being submitted to the Nomad cluster. The Nomad cluster will now evaluate all the changes and then allocate more resources. If I check out the job again on the dashboard, you can see there are now more containers running. You can see three of them are healthy at the moment. They're all listed down here and they are all separate containers that I can check out. So as you can see, it also assigned a random higher port to the whole thing, which means I can now access this container by using its higher port. It works. I can also check on one of the others that are running. Let's pick this one. Totally different port here as well, right? But running on the same machine. Obviously, in a professional context, you would have a load balancer here that is responding to port 80 or 8080 and then has the individual containers assigned to it. I just wanted to show you how easy it is to get a simple Docker container deployed with Nomad. All you need is the Nomad binary on a server machine, the Nomad binary on a client machine, but that's it, right? And then I just wrote this demo.nomad file, right, that we just saw. And that's it. That's all there is to it. No rocket science here. It's very easy to deploy a Docker application with Nomad. If you like this kind of video, I would be happy to do more. Please let me know in the comments what you liked about it, what you didn't like, what else you want to see. I'm happy to go deeper into the Nomad topic or other HashiCorp topics or any IT topic at all. And of course, it would be highly appreciated if you leave a like for this video, subscribe to our channel, and I'm gonna see you in the next one. Cheers.